Good evening, everybody. Thank you for joining us live on our Facebook page or on any of our streaming platforms. My name is Jacob Murphy.
And I'm Chasity Maynard.
And we are here with a live digital question and answer session following our three-part special report here at WCTV called The Three Oystermen. And Chasity and I are two-thirds of the team here at WCTV that brought this special to you, along with Sam Thomas, our excellent photog, who captured almost all of these visuals along with Chasity behind the camera. And throughout this session, we're gonna have a lot of the behind the scenes photos up behind us. Lots of fun photos of us out on the bay.
There you are.
There I am, there's Sam. So lots of cool stuff to keep an eye on in the background, hopefully not too distracting. But our goal here, Chasity, is that the 9 minutes or so we had on air and the web part, just not enough to capture the full story here. We could be here forever, but we thought we'd break it down a little bit and answer some questions.
Absolutely. This is such a big and important topic to all of Florida and a lot of the country, so we really just wanted to bring it to you today.
Yeah, and this feed, if you have any questions along the way, head to the bottom where you can submit comments, pose a question or two. If technology allows, I'll keep an eye on the feed on my phone, and we'll do my best to answer a few that you have. And if I don't get to your question because I missed it, I can perhaps answer some by typing it out after the show. But
yeah.
Really fascinating month-long process here. So Chasity, where do you want to start?
So can you tell me about how this project came to be? What made the team try to look into this?
Yeah, I believe it was Sam, actually, who came up with the idea in our newsroom sometime over the summer. He and you, I think, together maybe combined with, mm-hmm. with the thought about what's going on with the oysters. You know, I vaguely remember the shutdown news that came out in 2020. We're over halfway. What's going on? And I had done a couple stories around the 2020 shutdown time, but had not necessarily checked in since then and had the same question. I was like, that's a really good question. I don't know an answer for it. Are we on the right path? Are we not? And from there, we set forth and went down to the coast and started asking around, getting some answers, really eye-opening stuff about the situation, where it's at, and the fact that everyone has an opinion on this.
Yeah, and you know, like you said, it was a months-long reporting process. Were there any challenges, and what was that process like?
Well, it can be difficult if you haven't been in the community for a long time to just show up and knock on doors, so to speak, with a camera and ask folks to really open up about something that for many is really personal. So we actually got some help from a producer of a documentary that we're going to talk about in a few minutes, and they really have put in the effort for years to capture just an amazing documentary about the same issue. So they were kind enough to help us in certain directions. I had made a few contacts as well a few years ago. So through that point, we were able to get on the grounds there in East Point, have a few interviews set up, and of course, one interview can lead to another, and that's kind of how it plays out. And so that was the first challenge. And once we started getting information, then the question was, well, this isn't really a black and white topic. This is a gray topic with lots of angles, lots of opinions. How do you really sort through, filter out the important stuff versus the noise? And that's something you do in any story, really, in journalism. And you collaborate to figure out that. And I think we landed in a pretty good spot.
And what about any other challenges, particularly a weather-related one?
Well, yeah. We first went out in July. We did another session. We went back out, I think, twice in August, and we were ready to bring this to air early September. That was the plan a few weeks out. And I was about
supposed to be the week after Idalia.
Exactly. I was about a third of the way through and realized I had to put all that aside, focus on this huge natural disaster that was barreling down our region. And all the focus, of course, was on folks in Taylor, Madison, Suwannee, Hamilton, Lowndes counties for those weeks afterwards, and rightly so. But at some point I did check in, because we put all the stories on ice, checked in with all our contacts down there. And I was like, I know it didn't hit Franklin County directly, but were there any impacts? Does this really hurt anybody? And thankfully, for the FSU Coastal Marine Lab and the research they do, along with Florida Fish and Wildlife, they said no, they were fine, that the storm didn't hurt anybody, hurt any efforts, didn't knock any of the reefs down from what they understand, and that everything they have planned that we mentioned in the stories is still a go.
Thank goodness.
Which was really good to hear, and obviously there were still so many communities that didn't get hurt, so you got to keep this in context, but it was really good to see that didn't get speed bumped at all. The third element of our story about the aquaculture scene in Wakulla County, which of course was slightly closer to where Adelia made landfall, they did have issues, as we displayed today on our finale that aired at 6 today, that you can check out online, that they did have a huge mess to clean up. And Rob, who's right there on the left, this was after they cleaned up the mess, so you can see he's covered head to toe in mud there, and they had lines underwater with anchors that had been ripped up. What was a neatly organized grid was suddenly turned into a messy knot of lines that we were out there with them for a couple hours. And it was in October at this point, but it was still a hot sun. Mm-hmm. And I believe Rob's about 70. And to see him putting that effort in to try to rescue his business, it was tough to watch.
Absolutely. And tangling all of those ropes and having to take a hammer to try to get through a lot of the knots, it was really it seemed like an exhausting process as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And the good news for him, as we mentioned, is they did get shipments out. They are expecting repairs to be about 2 months or 3 months in the works. But once they get those finished, they'll finally be back to where they were pre-storm and hopefully be in good shape.
Yeah. So what struck you about Shannon Hartsfield's decision to work with the scientists?
So he was the Oysterman, the first of our three Oystermen we featured in Tuesday's report. He, like all three of them, spent decades out on the water. He was a part of a trade group for many years, the Seafood Workers Association there, a president of it, and told us, you know, year after year, fewer people would show up to the meetings. And really, by the end of it, he was the only one there. Just a tangible example that the trade had died out, that there was really no industry left. So when the 2020 decision came down, he was in favor because he figured this was the only option. They had to shut it down because the few oysters that would be there every year would be taken up very quickly. No one could make any sort of living out of it. And join the scientist who we also interviewed and has been integral in helping get some of those experiments done out in Apalachicola Bay. And from a perspective of maybe some folks out here in Tallahassee, it's like, okay, that's something he decided to do. But for that community, that was, you could say courageous, might be one word, brave, because he became vilified in many people's eyes. And every person in this story is vilified in a certain way. But he told us that he took a lot of heat from it, from the community, and would be approached at stores saying, you know, why did you do this? Where are we with this? Is there any hope? And that's a tough life to live.
Yeah, a really contentious topic. How many people are in the other camp from him, and are they right or wrong?
Yeah, Wayne Williams, the second oysterman we talked to, he is firmly in the other camp, a leading critic of the bay closure, someone who tried to petition the state with a change.org petition right after the first announcement came, and to no avail, obviously, and has started a counter nonprofit group, a trade group of sorts, that he says carries the torch for in his mind, 600 or 700 people in the community who share the same thought that the bay needs to reopen. Those numbers are hard to nail down exactly, because you ask everyone, and it's a nuanced position, so not everyone's in one camp or the other. So it's hard to pinpoint exactly which group has the majority. We did a poll on our website today asking, and the in favor of the shutdown was slightly larger than the not in favor, and a bunch of people who were not sure. Mm-hmm. So that's also unscientific, so it's hard to say. but who's right or wrong, it's hard to say. The scientists, I believe, have the best interests of the community at heart. That's not something Wayne necessarily believes in, though. And there are people who argue the scientists are more interested in research than returning to what was before. And those are just beliefs that are going to be hard to change. The scientists say they're working really hard, have tangible experiments that have been happening and will happen that they believe are on the road to recovery and want to reopen as soon as possible. So it's a difficult subject to bring up to a lot of folks. And who's right or who's wrong is obviously in the eye of the beholder.
Mm-hmm. And in such a controversial topic that people care about across the nation, you know, Apalachicola oysters are so well known. So it's easy to understand how people can have such strong feelings that are hard to change.
Right.
So what is aquaculture, this other component of the story, and when did it start?
So aquaculture is the component of our third story that aired today. It's essentially farming the ocean, farming the sea. It's a term that not too many people know. Obviously, everyone knows what agriculture is, but there might be a lot of people who don't know what aquaculture is, but it makes sense when you hear the word. Mm-hmm. And all things considered, it's still a relatively young industry. I did a lot of digging in our archives for everything, and you know, wild oyster harvesting stories dated back to the 90s, as far back as our archives go, but didn't see a ton of aquaculture stories until around the 2010s, 2013, we did a few, and if you watch our story with Rob, he's been operating since 2013. So there might be some folks who did it before then, but that's around when this started, so about a decade into it, really. And talking to Rob, you know, there's not a ton of state support for aquaculture compared to agriculture, and they're always advocating for more. It's hard to make a living off of it still. Mm-hmm. Even Rob says he doesn't really make a profit. You know, he's doing it, it's a business born out of passion, something, a second or third career that he's able to do later in life. But it's difficult really to make a living just given the problems we just talked about, the hurricane. Mm-hmm. So their access to seed is limited, as we mentioned as well. They only get one chance a year from a hatchery in Mobile, apparently, to get seed. And if it's a tough time of year, the weather doesn't cooperate when they put that seed, or spat, as it really is, you know, baby oysters, essentially. if it doesn't go well, then the whole crop for the 365 days can look different, right? So
yeah.
Like any farmer will tell you, so many things can go wrong because of Mother Nature. And so is it the future of the oyster? It's hard to say because of all the difficulties. As I mentioned, though, Rob doesn't really want to see a return to wild oyster harvesting. Mm-hmm. He values the role of an oyster so much that he really just wants all oysters to stay in the water, to filter, to be there for all those creatures that rely on them. So
yeah.
It's an interesting viewpoint as well. And as I said, not everyone's going to have an opinion that someone else in this community isn't a fan of.
Mm-hmm.
And the ability to be all at one table to hash it out is a difficult thing to do.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think one thing that all parties in this difficult topic can agree on is how important oysters are to the ocean, to the environment. And, you know, it's all these different ways of how do we continue serving the oysters, serving the people who love to eat oysters. And it's you know, one right answer is hard to come by. It's really difficult.
Gotcha. So I'm checking now our Facebook chat here to see if anyone has any questions. We do have one from Sabrina, who says, did you both expect the contentious nature of this project when you first took it on? And I'll start. I knew that there were some polarizing opinions. I didn't know it ran as deep as it did, but after it's all said and done, it's not surprising because of this is people's lives.
Mm-hmm. Well, I can jump in here too. How this story actually came to be was we had a caller come in who was really upset about the harvesting ban. He was a person who was incarcerated when the ban went into place. Before he was incarcerated, he was a harvester. That was his way of living. And so he called in. He had been recently released, and he was just saying, what am I supposed to do now? You know, and I know Sam, our photographer, has a history of life on the water. His father was a commercial fisherman, so I reached out to him and said, hey, I think this is something that would be right up your alley. So from the start for me, it was very clear that people were upset about this and that people had strong feelings about this. And that just sort of evolved more and more as I got to know the rest of these people that we spoke with who are so involved in trying to figure out the future of oysters.
Absolutely. So again, if you have any questions, feel free to drop them in the chat. We're keeping a close eye on it. We'll hopefully have a few more to answer here. For now, let's actually show you work that our photog Sam Thomas did. It's about 2 minutes. We call it a nat package. It just kind of puts you in the world of a profession for a few minutes. And this features Rob Olin, who owns Estuary Oysters, who we mentioned several times already, and Andrew McCoy, his employee, the former oysterman, our third mm-hmm. oysterman. I think you'll really get a sense of just how much a passion he has for the oyster and this industry. So enjoy that, and then when we come back, we'll have a special guest. So stay tuned.
Dedensifying the oysters and sorting them so they'll be more comfortable to grow when we put them back in the water. That's the core of what we do, because they grow faster here than anywhere else. Right here?
Yeah.
Let me see if I can hook it. We are blessed with our coast to have more farmable waters in our state than any other state in the Union. Depending on the time of year, depending on the size of the oysters that we have in the water, we might bring in 50 bags to work. Other days, depending with the weather and all, might be just 30 bags. As our oysters are out there refiltering the water, making life better for the 3,000 species that rely on them. Some of the hardest work, but you know, where else do you get to see life being reborn? What we're gonna do is pull these bags out of the water, load them up on land, and do all of our work there. Yeah, this is the stuff. But no two oysters grow at the same speed. You constantly have to sort them and give them room to grow. So that's what we do. We got in this to make a difference. We got in this to save the coast. We knew something had to happen. It's a beautiful day's work. We see things here that no one else sees unless they watch the Nature Channel. It's the prettiest office space on the planet.
Absolutely, and really nice job by Sam Thomas to put that together. So joining us now is Josh McLawhorn. He is a director of a fantastic documentary. It's called Unfiltered, The Truth About Oysters. And Josh, we really do appreciate you being here.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, taking time out of your evening here. And I mentioned earlier that we used a leg up, a little lift from Chucha Barbara, an executive producer, right, on the film. She helped us out a lot with just dipping our toes into this, what can be a contentious world, as you know well, I'm sure.
Very much so. That's definitely something that we encountered too.
Right. So if you could just start by taking us back to the origins of this film, years in the making. Where did it come from? Why did you guys really want to focus on this?
Well, the origins of the film actually came from Chucha Barbara, the producer, when she saw that Florida State University was getting a very large grant to study what was going wrong with the bay. She thought that there could certainly be a video component to that, alongside the FSU research, documenting what they were learning, what was happening to the bay. And as we started to do interviews and film and talk to different people, we realized that the story was so much bigger than that. And what was supposed to be maybe a 30-minute program turned into a feature-length documentary.
It's funny how that can happen, right? You never know what it's going to look like until you're out on the ground interviewing and collecting as much content as you can, right?
That's absolutely right.
Feels like it always evolves into something bigger.
It really does, and actually the finished documentary leaves so much on the cutting room floor. I think we have about 100 hours of footage, and the documentary is just shy of an hour and a half.
Wow.
So I understand we obviously, because you helped us kind of start our project, we interviewed many of the same folks across our projects. So one or two big takeaways from any of the folks that we also mentioned, whether it be Rob or Shannon, I believe are the two main ones that you took from when you first met them, what struck you about their lives?
Well, in the film, we profile four different people who are involved in the seafood industry in some way, and Shannon Hartsfield is one of them. And one of the things that I was incredibly struck by when we were interviewing Shannon and the others in particular is how much pride there is in the multi-generational way of life that they have. A lot of jobs and industries are very abstract, and they almost exist only within our modern society. But essentially what these people are doing is something that human beings have done from time immemorial. It's like hunter-gathering. So when that was taken away from them, it's very understandable how it was emotional and painful, and how a lot of people have very strong opinions about the closure of the bay. And Shannon in particular, I think he said that he was a third generation oysterman. And in the film, he talks about his son wanting to follow in his footsteps, but he kind of saw the writing on the wall as a father and told his son, you have to go and learn a trade. You have to do something else. You can't do the same thing that I did and that your grandfather did. And I imagine that was a very painful, you know, moment.
Mm-hmm. Right, and there might be other trades across time that die out for technological reasons, right, where it's just no longer something that needs to happen. But this isn't that, right? People would still happily buy those wild oysters if nature could accommodate. So mm-hmm. It has to be difficult psychologically to accept that as your fate, right?
That's true, and I learned through the project that a lot of people have very strong opinions as consumers about oysters. Mm. A lot of people think that the aquaculture oysters taste different than the wild ones, and so there is definitely a big component to that as well. I don't have enough of a refined palate to tell the difference. I'm
sure.
From Tallahassee. My very first oyster was in Apalachicola.
Okay.
Oh,
and
wow.
It was a fried oyster. It okay. took me, you know, that was when I was a kid, and it took me years to, you know, work my way up to steamed and then eventually raw.
Yeah.
And I shucked my first oyster on the back of a boat doing this project.
Okay.
Wow.
Yeah. So it was a growing experience for me too.
We didn't get that adventurous. We should have. Once we were out there with Rob, at least tried to.
Oh, Rob would have definitely taught you how to shuck and serve you some oysters.
Absolutely.
Jacob was teasing me as we were preparing this project because I've never had an
oyster.
Never
had an oyster. You dive into this and you've never had one. I know. I'm surprised you admit that on air here. I wasn't going to bring it up, but I told her, you know, you can start with fried and then work your way up, right?
Mm-hmm.
A raw oyster is an acquired taste. But for people who love it, I love it. Mm-hmm. It's nothing like it.
That is very true. And you know, a fun oyster fact, or maybe not so fun, a raw oyster is alive while you eat it.
Really?
It is not dead.
Oh my gosh!
You're eating a living organism.
Oh my gosh! I don't think I'm ever going to get to that level.
Wow. Yeah, if it's not alive, it's bad. You don't want to eat it.
That is true.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
Oh my God.
I knew they were alive for a long time, but I didn't know quite. Okay, that's interesting. Apologies if you suddenly are not a fan of raw oysters. That wasn't our intention, but I'm glad you brought that up. That's crazy.
I'm full of oyster facts at this point.
Oh, I bet you are.
One thing I wanted to know is that this is, you know, so reminiscent to me of another really big Florida industry that's suffering right now, and that's the orange industry, where again, this is generations of people that are depending on nature to support themselves and are at a place where the environment is different than what it was even when they were growing up. And they're having to talk to their, you know, their children and say, you know, we're probably gonna sell our groves. Don't look at this to be your future, even though it was grandpa's and great grandpa's or whatever it is. It's just so interesting because, you know, I think Florida is known for its sea life and oranges, and it's just so interesting to see the way that the environment is changing and how it's shaping our financial industry here.
And while that environment changes and the industries change, that doesn't necessarily change consumer demand. I mean, people mm. still want to eat oranges, they want to drink orange juice, people still want oysters on their plate. And as you mentioned, that's where aquaculture is kind of filling that demand gap in, you know, the current lack of wild oysters coming out of Apalachicola Bay and other bays around Florida.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And I'd imagine when we do long form for us projects, we always have a story or two that we always remember out in the field. I imagine with the years and hours of footage, are there one or two moments in filming the documentary that have always stuck with you since completion that you'll always kind of cherish or laugh at or really stick with you?
You know, all of those things. One person we interviewed is Tommy Ward, and he's a multi-generational oysterman, and he was very emotional during our interview. It took our producer, Chucha Barber, years of trying to come at him from different angles to find when we could interview him to get him to even agree. And, you know, the day we filmed his interview, we kind of just ambushed him, you know, and he did not want to talk about this. And I'm sure this is something that you encountered as well. It was very, very painful. And he still is a commercial fisherman, but his business does only shrimp now. And that was a very emotional interview, and it just, that was, it was just, it was so raw, and he was so real, and he wasn't holding anything back. And you rarely get those kind of experiences, because people tend to be guarded and people tend to be rehearsed and things like that, and he was none of those things. So that was definitely one moment that will certainly stand out. I learned so much in the project. I mean, when we started the project, I knew I liked to eat oysters. I didn't realize how foundational they are for the environment and how many other species depend on them. Mm-hmm. One thing that it's obvious when you think about it, but you don't think about it, you know, most organisms are not their own environment, but oysters are. So an oyster reef is the place where new oysters will colonize and grow.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So if reefs get depleted down to nothing, the environment is gone. I mean, the animals themselves are the environment, not just for themselves, but for crustaceans and fish, and you know, they filter the water, and so they take all those little bits of particulate matter out of the water, they make the water clear, sunlight can penetrate, seagrasses grow, seagrass is another environment. I mean, it's this whole feedback loop that's very positive when you have a healthy oyster population. So I think that's the biggest takeaway for me, is just how important oysters are to other species, including humans.
Yeah, and when folks watch your film or read reports or see reports, you know, there's just a level of anxiety that develops, right, about the future of the oyster. Did you guys uncover a call to action or something the average person could do or should support to maybe help this cause going forward?
Absolutely. That is very much how the film ends, is with calls to action about what can happen on an individual level, on a municipal, local level, a statewide level, and frankly, on a federal level. I'll start with local. I think being very conscious of the people you vote for and what their commitment to the environment and environmental issues is, I think is something that individual people can do to make a difference, because this is a giant issue, and sometimes when you're dealing with giant issues, it's overwhelming and you feel like there's nothing you can do. If you live in a coastal community and they're doing shell recycling efforts and reef restorations, you know, go out there. It's fun. You know, you're waist deep in the water. It's, you know, it's a day of hard work and it's a lot of fun. So I think that's something that, you know, individuals can do. I think at a local level, you can look for public-private partnerships. In the film, we down in Longboat Key, we profiled a group of restaurants that are essentially taking the oyster shells and collecting them in separate trash bins rather than just putting them into trash, which would of course go to a landfill. Mm-hmm. Then the local waste collection company, Waste Pro, down there, collects those. They let them bleach in the sun, and then they use those shells that came from restaurants in shell recycling efforts. And so it's supported by the county down there. I mean, it's this public-private partnership, so that's, yeah, you know, a more local thing. I think on a statewide level, what people can do to help is talk to their lawmakers about good water management policy, about good environmental resource management policy, and making sure that we, first of all, don't have no plan in, yeah, place. There must be a plan. And second of all, being very conscious about development in sensitive environmental areas. And on a federal level, going all the way to the, yeah, top, I think that Congress needs to amend the Rivers and Harbors Act to account for downstream environmental impact to the management of river systems, because a lot of people know about the Florida-Georgia water wars,
sure,
and which was, you know, in 2021 the Supreme Court ruled in favor of Georgia. The law essentially is set up such that the Army Corps of Engineers manages rivers for hydropower, flood control, and navigation. The legislation doesn't talk about environmental impact. And so if the law were amended to include some considerations for that, I think that would have huge positive benefit for river systems all around the country, not just the Apalachicola River.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know Dr. Brooke with FSU had talked about the Army Corps engineers and what they may be able to do and aren't doing, or, you know, so I think that's exactly what you're getting at. We did get one more question from Grace, who asks if anyone outside of the actual industry itself has strong opinions about the shutdown. And I think it's safe to say that they do, right? Even if you're not a fourth generation oyster farmer, if you grew up in East Point or Apalachicola, you took pride in that, right?
Absolutely. I didn't really, you know, it's like you don't think about what you have until it's gone sometimes. Mm-hmm. And so I think having pride in your community means supporting your community. And there are different opinions about what makes a community great. And I think having a dialogue about that is so critical for any community.
Yeah, I remember when we were looking around Apalachicola for this project, I mean, everywhere it says oysters, you know, even when you first enter Apalachicola, it says the oyster capital of the world. So I can imagine that that's so tied into people's identities there in a way. I can imagine that, you know, you don't have to be a part of the industry to feel that connection. It's a part of your home.
And I saw examples of that too. I mean, if you go to the, I don't want to say what it is because I can't remember specifically which business, but you know, they'll have these shirts that say, "Got oysters?"
Okay.
But the answer right now is no.
No, not naturally.
And
not
so well. You see things like that and it stings. So
absolutely. So we're going on almost 40 minutes here, so don't want to keep folks too long. If you could, I know the best chance to see Unfiltered was probably at the Tallahassee Film Festival in early September, which I understand was a really exciting moment for you and the whole team. You won an award. Can you explain what that award was and kind of just the overall reaction to the film here at home?
Sure. We were so grateful to be chosen for the best feature documentary at the Tallahassee Film Festival. We had a packed house, people came out, and we're so grateful for everyone who came out to watch the film. And I think really it just speaks volumes about how much local people know about this issue and care about this issue. The next place to watch the film is gonna be at the Fort Lauderdale International Film Festival. We're airing at 7:15 p.m. on Saturday, November 4th, down in Fort Lauderdale. Which is an awesome time slot for such a big film festival.
Great.
We were really grateful to get that time slot. We just look forward to hopefully being able to make a deal with a streaming service like Netflix or Amazon to be able to essentially take the documentary into people's homes so that people don't have to go to a film festival to watch it. We're hoping to be streaming to your home before too long.
Yeah, I'm hoping so too. And it was fascinating talking to Chucha about the process of going from a great documentary film to what it takes to go from that to on your Netflix screens, for example. So that's a whole inside baseball conversation, but we're hoping that does happen because it is a fantastic film. And as soon as it does happen, we'll let our viewers know too.
Yeah.
So
that
they can
turn on their TVs and just watch it. Because again, as you said, so many people take pride in this and
for good reason.
For good reason, absolutely.
Yeah.
Was there anything else you wanted to touch on before we sign off here?
I just wanted to thank your whole team, Jacob, Chasity, your entire team for, you know, bringing awareness to this important issue, because in our modern world with mass media and social media and, you know, everyone being able to seek out kind of just what they want, it's really important to talk about the things that really matter. I mean, I think the health of our oceans and our coasts is critical really all over the world, but particularly in Florida. I mean, we're a huge peninsula and people come here for the water. People come here for the water experiences. And if we have red tide, if we have, you know, flesh-eating bacteria, if the water isn't able to, you know, if you can't swim in the water, it just changes the place that we all call home. And so thank you for your reporting and journalism on this really important issue. Our whole team, I know that if Chucha were here, she would be thanking you as well.
Well, we really appreciate
thank
that,
you.
And it's mutual because, again, you guys helped us out big time in getting this off the ground. I did want to, if you could shout out the website that folks can go to at least watch the trailer, which is phenomenal in its own right.
Sure, absolutely. The website is oyster.film. Easy to remember.
Oyster.film. Yeah, I was going to put it down in the
easy.
Comments. And again, that's the poster, an awesome poster, too.
Mm-hmm.
So that oyster.film is the place to go to watch. It's like a 2.5-minute trailer, right? With the drone shots you guys got over the water escapes there are just incredible. So
thank you so much.
Thank you again, Josh, for coming on. For folks who stayed on and watched this, we really do appreciate it. If you catch this on a replay hours or days from now, feel free to leave a comment anyway. We'll keep tabs on this and can type up an answer to a question if you have one. We always appreciate that interaction.
And if you missed the original airing of these stories, you can catch them on WCTV.tv. They're on our homepage. They're on our special reports page. It's a labor of love, yes. And we really hope that you enjoy it for years to come. It'll be there for a long time.
Absolutely. And we'll, as you will, Josh, keep a close eye on developments. Our newsroom will, of course, report on our newscasts. If FWC makes any determinations in the next year or 2 years, they have a big restoration project on tap for next year. So we're not saying goodbye to this story. It's just so long for now, right? And we're going to keep a close eye. And who knows, maybe there'll be a sequel to Unfiltered one day with a happy ending.
I hope so.
Absolutely. All right, folks, thanks so much for spending some time with us here. Have a good night.